Hey everybody, welcome to the program. I'm Chris Rippey, and today my guest is Christopher King. He's an author, ethnomusicologist, archivist, and collector. He wrote this book, Lament from Epirus, which I highly recommend that you read. It's very riveting. So let's welcome Chris to the program. Hey Chris, how's it going?
I'm doing all right, man. Hello everybody.
All right, so today Christopher and I are going to listen to some records with you, and using them as a focus, we're going to ask the question, what is music for? Where does it come from and why? So Chris, why don't you tell us a bit about the first track we're going to listen to and how that relates to your work, how it led you to write this book, how it pertains to the overall question of what music is for.
Well, the first record I'm going to play is a disc by Alexis Zumbas. It is recorded in 1926 in New York City. But Alexis was not an American. He was Greek. He was from this region of Greece in the northwestern part called Epiros. And when I discovered his music in conjunction with the music of Kitsos Harisiadis, a clarinetist from the same region, it put me down this rabbit hole of trying to understand what the actual purpose was of this music. Because, you know, we can easily answer what music is. We can use Blacking's definition, which is namely music is humanly organized sound. But what Blacking and so many others don't do is ask organized to what end. And when you listen to music from Epirus, as an outsider, as an American, for me, I detected purposefulness. There was a structure, there was an intentionality to the music. And yet I could not possibly understand what it was for. What was this intended to do to people? Because it's not dance music, and it certainly is not pop music. It's a piece of music that at the time I thought it was unlike anything else. But first, I'll play this for you. This is 1926. This is Alexis Zumbas. This is Epirtiko Miraloi, which is a lament from Epirus. And there's the record, too. Whoop. I'm not used to all this. Okay.
What year is this record from again?
1926.
1926, recorded in New York City?
In New York City. All right.
Okay, so many questions leap to mind in the wake of hearing something like that. But I suppose I'll start with what is the meaning of the title? What is a merloi?
Merloi is an ancient Greek concept of lamentation, of bemoaning, of keening, of singing remembrance poetry to those that are departed. And in the larger sense, when one departs, it can obviously be through death. You can read Merloia in the texts of Homer, but in the broadest sense, Merloi can also mean those that leave through marriage because you're leaving your family. Merloi will be sung at a traditional marriage. Also, when people are expatriated, when they're traveling abroad to work, that is known as xenetia, as being estranged from one's soil. And that's a particular sub-branch of Merloia, of these songs of remembrance, of recollection, of regret, of missing someone, of missing people, and also of the village missing those people. So it's a very, very rich concept. And when you listen to that particular piece by Zumbas, my feeling is he was recording that a little over a decade after he had relocated to America. And he did not know if he was going to be returning back to Greece. And so a transformation took place in his music. He was keening through his violin. He was longing for Epirus. It was a lament for Epirus.
So there's a real sense, a palpable sense when you listen to it of that. Something very strikingly full of longing, full of sorrow, but it's beautiful. So when we're talking about the function of music, is there something here about connecting to what is otherwise an impossible emotion, some sort of despair or longing that's unresolvable, and yet in the context of playing the music, listening to the music, experiencing the music, it somehow is able to help you experience those emotions in a healing or transformative kind of way.
Yeah, that's what I discovered over the course of the last 9 years of researching this book and of talking to musicians, villagers, aficionados of the music, that the Mirloy, both as a vocalized piece as well as an instrumental piece, it is designed, its function is to evoke catharsis, to allow us to bubble over with sadness and misery so that once the process is over, we're kind of burned clean. You know, it's kind of like that feeling that if you were younger and you would go away to bed weeping over having your heart broken, that you would never recover. Well, when you finished the weeping, when you finished the crying, you felt fine. You felt good again, or at least I did the one time it happened.
So, in that sense, then, does this kind of music, you had mentioned it's an ancient Greek kind of connection. So, are we talking about a kind of music that goes back in time in some way that you can measure or is connected to a deeper sense of time than much of the music that we're familiar with now?
Yeah, I think the Greeks, because it was an intentionally informed piece of music, they took thousands of years to perfect this notion of taking a relatively simple scale. That's a pentatonic scale. It's five notes, of taking five notes and arranging them in just such a way that it triggers catharsis. It targets a particular human emotion, and there's a great Greek word that describes targeting the heart of the listener, and that's what these pieces of music do, and it's one among many in the Greek repertoire that do target emotions, that do spring this sort of font of overwhelming sadness. In this case, there are also pieces of music that exist that do the exact opposite. They trigger exuberance and happiness. But you're right. This is an ancient piece of music, and the way I like to think about it, it's an ancient tool. It's an ancient way of taking something and giving it a function that we needed. Music exists because of needs. this piece of music answers particular needs for that region, for those people.
So Zumbas then was an inheritor of a tradition that had been continuously altered or refined or handed down for presumably millennia. And then when recording this in New York, being separate from home, and as you said, there's a specific kind of term for that, a kind of longing, a kind of darkness, if you will, around that. And he played this in a studio for a recording, which was a new technology, a new-ish, with an upright bass, which was not a traditional instrument, So he was using, new tools, different elements, and yet was still retained that connection to the deep past. And this, of course, reminds me of what I think our next piece is going to be, the American blues, and also just American music traditions in general, having strongly to do with people who are displaced. And in the earlier generations of America, and you deal with people who are displaced in pretty intense ways, to say the least. And the musical traditions that spring from that seem to deal with the same kind of emotional subject matter that we're talking about with Zumbas. So, what is the next piece that we will be listening to, the next record?
Well, the next piece is a recording that I write about also in the book, and I write about in conjunction with Zumbas because it shares hauntingly deep similarities. It too is a pentatonic piece, five notes. It too is actually played in the same key, the key of D. It is also a wordless piece. It's not a vocalized piece like Zumbas's violin instrumental. And its purpose, as much as I can gather, is quite similar. It is intended to evoke catharsis and longing. And yet, because we're Americans and because American collectors tend to covet things by deeming them as blues, this has been understood as the penultimate blues record.
I see.
But this is Blind Willie Johnson's Dark Was the Night, Cold Was the Ground, which was famously launched into outer space, not the record that I'm going to play, but a recording of the record in Voyager space probe in order to prove to alien life forms that would discover this capsule that we ourselves were capable of intensely deep, abstract, emotional expressions. So,
Wonder what Blind Willie would think about
exactly.
his music being sent into space as a representation of humanity's capacity for abstract expression.
Right. But this is essentially, as you listen to it, you'll realize structurally it is nearly identical to the Zumbas piece. It just happens to be from Texas one year later than the Zumbas
One
piece.
year. And there it is, Blind Willie.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So there really is something in that that taps in precisely the same vein as the Zumbas did as well, and you can hear it so strikingly. It seems that, you know, American music had a kind of a connection to the deep past in a way that's very different in that from the Zumbas or from, you know, Greek music, in that it's a connection that has to be made largely with very few resources. The South, American South particularly, seems to be kind of a crucible in which, you know, the person finds themselves stripped of their, you know, history, stripped of their connections, and has to kind of look within and take, you know, what they have and what's, you know, left to start something new. And then we see this accelerated development in the South, where, you know, the musical culture just goes so fast to get back to where it has the tools to express itself in such a way that you might find in a musical culture that has been continuously developing and been handed down, you know, from generation over generation. And of course, we have so many different kind of cultural streams going together. So what kind of influences went into Blind Willie's music? What led him to be able to do that? I mean, what manner of tradition or what manner of, you know, culture was he, you know, reflecting or responding to? Or is that just too broad of a question, too many threads to follow?
I don't know, Christ, man, that's a hard question. I mean, obviously he was the descendant of slaves. That much is very clear. And the fact that he would have been growing up in a recently freed South, but still not freed at all, him being black and being under the yoke of oppression and being classified as much less than a man. But the musical sources it would have pulled from would obviously have been African, and certainly the genesis of playing music on the slide guitar to get those quarter notes, to get that crying sound, was a huge advancement in black vernacular music as well as black secular music. But the thing that I have to ask myself is, what context was that piece of music that he just played? What was the context for that? What was it meant to do? Who was listening and for what reason? And at that point, it dawned on me, we don't have the documentation. We don't have the resources to know who would have listened to that, under what context and under what circumstances. We can only conjecture that it would have been an instrumental basically played to evoke a deep emotion. And so then one can easily imagine slaves as well as post-Civil War blacks creating a piece of music through which they could mourn their losses. And that, to me, is what the piece is. And the fact that it ends up being pentatonic in the key of D and sharing similar embellishments and repeated phrases as Zumbas, that to me is a beautiful mystery.
It hints at something potentially universal. It hints at something potentially that if you were separated from cultural influence of any kind, not that you could be, but hypothetically, and you had at least the idea of music and you had sorrow and you had an instrument, that you would probably come up with something similar to someone else far removed from you who was doing the same thing. That somehow there are scales, somehow there are emotions involved in music that, strike that chord within us.
And also just think about musicians as those that doctor the pain, there's something which is pain, mm-hmm. and something needs to be created as a tool to work against pain. In this case, the pain of alienation, sorrow, regret, being in a dismal state. Who better to treat the pain than a musician?
Right. And it does seem like a very intimate kind of expression to be caught on record. I would like to have seen the moment. Now, speaking as someone who does record basically all every day, I have to tell you, there's a major self-conscious hurdle that you have to get over. And for me, it took a couple of years of constantly recording, you know, till now I just forget about it, because that's become a real value. I realize that if you're going to put something down that's got your presence, that makes your mark in the way that these old recordings do, that self-consciousness needs to be absent, and that you just tap into that vein and just pour yourself out as much as you can, and let the microphone be, you know, the participant in that. And that is something that I think only comes from either lots and lots and lots of experience with recording, or like none. You know, right. You're just so used to sitting down for yourself or for your friends or for whomsoever it might have been, mysteriously in this case, we don't know, and done something with a purpose, you know, that therapeutic purpose, or perhaps, you know, they probably weren't thinking that it was medicine or healing. They were probably just doing it to do it, right?
They were doing it because that's what they had been doing all their lives, and they were perfectly unself-conscious. Right. About the act.
And that's why it comes out beautiful. Catch that on those early records, and I think that's part of what makes this so fascinating, that we're dealing with musicians who just are like, okay, sing into this can. All right, man, you know? And then it seems a curious thing to sell a record on, too. Yeah, I'm going to just moan on a guitar for a little while. I wonder if he saw any returns on that sort of thing, or what he expected out of it.
He died penniless.
Well, there you go. It's a tragedy, all too familiar, unfortunately. Well, that kind of leads us into the next, segues us into the next track here. Also American South, also blues, but something really, really special and different. Can you give us some context to this before we jump into it?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think we were talking right before we aired this program, sort of, and I have to comment upon the unreality of this situation of giving a presentation from my record room to hundreds and hundreds of people, that you know, being a record collector, you're used to being a hermit and you know, generally speaking, just disliking humanity. But being cooped up so long, you actually want to get out. And so when I'm on this camera, I feel almost like it's not animal kingdom, but it's like collector kingdom. This is what collectors look like when they've been locked up for 4 months. So the record that I'm about to play has been my holy grail. It has been an acquisition that I have been unable to get for 25 years since I first heard it at a friend's house, Joe Buzzard's house. He had a copy. And I've been wanting this record ever since I heard it. And finally, just last month, I acquired it in a trade. This is a record that was recorded by a man on the label as Big Boy Cleveland. And from that, we can infer practically nothing other than the fact that he may have been big and he was a boy. And he either had the last name of Cleveland or he could have hailed from Cleveland, Mississippi, which is what I think. He only did one record. He recorded three sides, but only two were issued. And this is a piece of music called Quill Blues, and it's played on the syrinx, which is the quills. It's basically a set of canes that have been shaped and then truncated to produce pitches that you blow across. Henry Thomas played the quills. But this is unique in that it is not only with no other instrumentation, but also no vocal. It's simply him playing a tune on the quills. We'll play it. I'll play it for you, and then we can talk about what it conjures. Because one reason why I wanted it is because it's a record that seemingly connects everything. It's a missing link. It's a Rosetta Stone. It draws all the strings together. So,
all right.
I must be very fragile when I hold it up. See how nice and clean it is?
Oh my goodness. And what year is this record from?
1927.
1927.
Yeah. So this is Quill Blues by Big Boy Cleveland. All right.
Very happy and exciting piece of music. It sounds like there's a dance kind of rhythm implied. I could hear that easily going with some drums for being a blues. And tell us about, like, where does this fall in the development of blues? What makes it a missing link?
I think it is a piece that represents the genesis of all things that we now come to understand as American vernacular music. If you understand blues as being a derivative, I'm sorry, if you understand rock and roll as being somewhat of a derivative of blues, the whole American storybook is contained in that one record. I was talking to one of my best friends, Gary Hardcastle, about this very disc that you listen to it one time and it sounds like a boogie-woogie piano piece, like Cow-Cow Blues or a piece played by Louise Johnson. And then you listen to it again, and then it reminds you of a dance piece, Jackson Stomp, that was also recorded about the same time period, but using mandolin and guitar, basically a hillbilly piece. And then you listen to it again, and it reminds you of a New Orleans jazz piece, My Bucket's Got a Hole in It. You listen to it again, and then if you imagine it being played slightly slower and slinkier, then it becomes one of those slow shimmy-shee wobbles, what were referred to as coitus pieces that were played in juke joints where people would simulate sex. So it has almost this widespread functionality that was then dispersed along what we now consider to be different genres of music, now manifested as American blues. But I think it reaches way back before the Civil War when all of this sort of primordial soup of American music was just bubbling, was just starting to take form.
All performed on a cane flute, which is something that you don't really see or hear about at all. What's the origin of that?
Well, it is, and once again, this is a bizarre thing. It is a Greek instrument. It's an ancient Greek instrument. Pan, of course, played it because it took his namesake, the pan pipes. But it was also a piece that would have been found in Africa, West Africa, Northwest Africa as well, that you would have played very simple melodies on it. And so it's conceivable that either it was something that was an instrument that would have been quote unquote imported and made in America by African slaves, or it could have just very well been the genius of a man cutting down some cane and making them to sound like bird sounds. I mean, there is solid documentation from the late 1700s and early 1800s of people in the South observing slaves playing the panpipes.
So again, it's potentially connected to longstanding traditions that people would have remembered, or it's potentially just attributable to some sort of common impulse among people wherever they are to take some cane or bamboo or something and blow into it. I've heard many origin stories about the flute over the years coming from many different cultures, and it seems to be always related to something like a bird or the wind. And, you know, as I listen to this in a similar light, you know, it reminds me of the instrument that I play from Indonesia called the suling, which translates to good cry, according to Balinese friend of mine. And it is a piece of bamboo, just about this big to this big, you know, any size they find, cut through the node end, tiny little notch and a piece of rattan wrapped around it. And it's possibly the cheapest instrument. It's cheaper than a penny whistle. Certainly, it takes skill to craft and to make sound good. But, you know, when you pick it up and play it, it's easy to underestimate. It's easy to just hear toots. But with a little bit of time, this thing weeps and wails and cries and glissandos and does all of these things. And it's just a piece of cane. And it seems, you know, so far flung from the American South or from Greece. You know, and yet here we are, you know, talking about this traditional flute that serves presumably the same purpose and is made of much the same materials. So it does seem to have a universal element to it. And the name would imply as well a kind of universal purpose. And so this piece is really, really fascinating. Thank you. I think this is like the world debut of the Quill Blues or something, is it?
Yeah. Quite possibly. One hell of a great record.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And you're right, listening to it, it does have like everything from like I hear like 70s funk music in it. You know what I mean? I hear, you know, blues. I hear, you know, all of this incredible stuff just descending from this simple scale. And this, again, it's a 5-note pentatonic scale.
Right.
So that's fascinating that keeps coming back. Have you ever seen the thing where Bobby McFerrin tours around and gets people to sing the pentatonic scale? He's gives you two notes and he kind of jumps back and forth and has the audience sing those two notes. And then he jumps a third direction and he hasn't given you that note, but the audience anywhere in the world will instantaneously fill in the correct note of the pentatonic scale. And then he'll go and then he'll basically have the audience just by spontaneous, you know, interaction, self-generate the pentatonic scale. And he says he's been all over the world and it's worked everywhere he's been. So there's something really powerful about that. You know, and we talk about its origins in the Overtone series, but we rarely talk about the connection of those overtones to our psyche, to our physical makeup, and to what each one, you know, might do to us, you know, and all the different transpositions possibly of the scale, and how it when we transpose it sounds minor, or you know, which drone we decide to hold against it. There's so many different possible moods that can be evoked from five simple notes. And in fact, the more notes that we add to a scale, sometimes the less specifically it targets one mood. It might become very good at being able to be versatile and move through different regions because it has a lot of information available to it. So a classical composer might like it to be able to travel and to modulate. But when we're talking about simply having a scale, which when presented in its almost naked form on an instrument, is immediately evocative of a state of mind or a mood or a kind of consciousness, it seems that the limitation of the five-note scale is almost superior for that purpose.
Yeah, well, we're very, very far behind in trying to figure out exactly how well our ancestors developed music to affect us in a particular way. And that'll be the next piece that we play. But first, you told me you gotta shake your moneymaker, right?
Oh, yes. I wanted to put out there for everyone, this content is made possible by and put on by the Autumn Salon. We are doing a fundraiser with this in all of our videos, so please donate. You will see the link below both the YouTube video, if that's where you're watching, or on the page for the Autumn Salon. The donate button is there. Your support goes towards this program, towards Christopher King himself, and also towards being able to put on future programming, interviews, articles, musical performances, and sort of interesting interactions such as this one. So your support is greatly appreciated, and thank you very much. All right, so let's move on to our next item here. Tell us about this next record.
Yeah, this is a real oddity because one of the things that an ethnomusicologist or an anthropologist is challenged with is trying to make sense of something where we no longer have the proper informants to tell us what the meaning of the phenomenon is. Now, this piece of music is Turkman, but the Turkman have been so displaced and marginalized, and this piece of music therefore lost its purpose because we no longer have those that can interpret it to us. So radical has the culture changed. This particular piece was recorded, and I've taken extensive notes, as you can see. I have to scribble on these things.
Oh, yeah.
This thing was recorded in 1933 in Constantinople. This is from the southwestern region of what is now Turkey. This is the title of the piece is Aydın Taksim Bi Ayan Havasi, and it translates to improvisation from Aydın and folk dance. The musician, he's got a great name. It translates to Little Ali, the tough guy. And I'm assuming that Ali is the chief instrumental player on this. But this is basically, in my estimation, a piece, a record in two parts, one of which is, I guess, best described as a piece of music to put you under. It's a trance piece. It's a very primeval way of relaxing the senses so that you're not centered on anything. And then the second part of the piece is a dance piece. So
that's an interesting juxtaposition. I love this one for that reason.
So, and it's what you would call a tribal piece. So here you go.
All right.
All right. Thank you.
já, que eu ali, pega já.
I just love that one. The juxtaposition between the parts is really interesting, because there is sort of this lull. It's very like soothing, kind of despite the violin being very sort of dynamic and strident and full of double stops and just sort of playing techniques which, you know, each one of those techniques, you know, is used frequently today, but in exactly the way that player is able to put them together and translate them into something. I never heard anybody play just like that. I mean, that's a very strange and interesting and absolutely beautiful musical language to somebody who hasn't heard it before. And it strikes me, you know, this connection to music having a purpose, that there's an element that is, you know, this soothing, sort of self-soothing almost kind of element of for the musician and their immediate community. There is the idea of grappling with impossible emotions that we sort of talked about in the beginning, but now there's this sort of centering, calming, like you said, detaching the senses from any particular, you know, activity and just putting it directly on that centering kind of music. And then you get, of course, swept up into this dance rhythm, and I just love those drums. And it's an interesting place to, it's interesting juxtaposition, but it feels like a natural one to me, in the sense that the relaxed, sort of supple person is able to get swept into the vibe of the dance and carried away into it, into the sort of ecstasy of it, much more easily. And that the two things sort of seem like a natural kind of push and pull. So what can you tell us about the now that I've given you my conjecture, the origins of this thing and what purpose it might have been serving for the actual people who created it.
Geez, man. I like to think of that as bar talk meets belly dance.
Yeah.
because, you know, the very gapped and, as you would say, strident spike fiddle tones, they really do put me under, and I'm certainly not Turkmen. And then it moves to this very fast tseftiteli, you know, belly dance piece. I can only conjecture that this was a piece of music that was created. They created it themselves to entertain themselves, to do just that, to put themselves under and then to sort of liberate themselves through and admittedly a very sensual dance. Makes perfect sense that when you are part of a tribal structure, you're a herdsman and you're traveling just with a small group of people, you need to come up with your own ways of making music, fixing yourself. And that's a piece of music that I think really it fixed those that heard it. Now, it's a miracle that it got recorded, because, you know, you think about it, they're in the plains of Anatolia with their sheep and their goats. What was the chance that they would have just stumbled into a studio in Constantinople and made that? But regardless, I'm pretty happy that it happened.
Was there like a Turkish Alan Lomax just sort of out there looking for these guys or something? You know, somebody in the field saying, "Hey, come to my recording studio and put this down," and then, you know, five people listen to it, and then here we are 100 years later.
Well, probably, yes, five people did listen to it. It's pretty rare. But on the other hand, there was, I don't think at that point there was anything like a Turkish Alan Lomax.
No.
The Turkish music industry was like any other music industry, and that is they wanted to make bank. And so probably these musicians showed up at the studio and they could tune their instruments and play proficiently, and they were allowed to make two recordings, and then they sort of faded into oblivion.
So presumably there was somebody at the other end of this who wanted to buy it. So there's the,
Yes.
they thought they could target this somehow, which is interesting. I wish we could know more about the history of these things, these untold stories. You know, and it strikes me as well, you said it's a miracle it got recorded. I mean, so much of the work of what I do with Tales of the Boatman, of the Autumn Salon in general, is to look at, you know, art forms that have a living connection to something that is largely becoming more and more imperiled, and that is a living connection to art forms that extend deep into the past. And it doesn't necessarily mean that it's, you know, you're reproducing these art forms in exactly the same way. Of course not. It just means, like Zumbas, that, you know, artists today are presumably able to do something new or with unique ingredients available to them, and yet be tapping into the same feelings, the same sense of purpose, not a sense of purpose, but the same actual purpose. And that when I sit down and, you know, pour myself into, you know, my banjo, that connects me to people who have been doing the same thing, and that there's sort of their blood, their story, their history, coinciding, you know, with mine. And that's a lot like a language. You know, a musical culture is like a language, and there's so many languages lost, what, every day, and there's so many more, and we often don't perceive what it is that we're losing when that happens. And it seems like with each form, we've talked about the universals, you know, with blues, with Greek music, you know, within these forms there are universals, and there are things that are common to between languages, shall we say, and we can watch how they've grown and from what origins they come, and we can see the similarities. And yet with every culture and with every language of music, there's also something deeply specific to that place, to those people. And there's something not only of their legacy historically, but I believe something of their legacy in the presence of the music. Like the actual person can be experienced in the hearing of the music. Like somehow the gramophone has captured the brain waves of a long dead individual connected to a series of other long dead individuals who have something unique to say based on where they're from a sense of not only place, but of where you're from in time and in experience. And being a part of that continuum can only deepen the effects of whatever music's purpose really is. And what is that? And so far, we've talked a lot about this concept of healing, of soothing, of fixing. Presumably, one would be more able to do that being part of a continuum, having that electrical current of the past running through you. And that's not to lock you into the shackles of some sort of tradition, but rather to electrify you so that you can be also a conduit for that current. And therefore, what you make will be unique, but it will be connected to that origin. And that strikes me as so important about these records and what they stand for. It's not just hearing a curiosity from the past, but it's hearing the mind or the spirit or the presence of not only an individual, but a continuum of individuals from the past in a way that reminds us that that's been really interrupted, and that that's something that we would do well for ourselves to reconnect to. And actively looking for ways to reconnect to that has proven to be a very difficult life's work. So I can attest to the limits that one finds themselves up against. So I just want to say how much I appreciate being able to hear these records and for you sharing them with us, because it's one more step in that process, and I think a very important one. So our last record then is, please introduce this record for us.
Well, yeah, I mean, speaking about the record in relationship to the tradition, I mean, I have to admit that although I love my 78s dearly, they are essentially fossils. They're snapshots of time frozen in place. They capture a particular culture and a particular individual at a very specific time and convey that idiosyncratic performance without variance. That's just that happens not to be the way that vernacular or folk music works. Folk music does evolve. It does change. It both improves and it degrades. And oftentimes it disappears. You know, no no one person, nor one institution, nor even really one group of people can preserve music. Music is preserved by those that participate in it. If a piece of music, if a type of music is valuable, the people that play it and listen to it and dance to it and sing it, they value it and they perpetuate it. No one person can prop it up and keep it going. Otherwise, it becomes a farce. It becomes a carnival act. But as a way of introduction to this record, there used to be a very, very large population of what are called Limko Ukrainians. These are Ukrainians that lived in the mountains that sung in a very specific style and had very unique religious practices. They had their own culture. They created it themselves and they perpetuated it. And there are still Limko Ukrainians. There are even Limko Ukrainians still in Ukraine. But by and large, the population moved to the United States to find a better way of life. Those that stayed behind, not all of them, but most of them, fell victim to warfare, first by the Nazis, and then by the communists, by Stalin's communists, more or less wiped out this indigenous population that created, in my estimation, one of the most beautiful bodies of music. What I'm about to play for you is, it's a commercial recording. It was sold in the U.S., but it was actually recorded surreptitiously right before the beginning of World War II. I talked to the informant. A man went to essentially a barn party that was being hosted by the Limko Ukrainians in their village. And underneath his jacket, he had a portable recording device, and he recorded it, and then he made these discs, and then these discs were sold in the United States. But what it represents is, in my mind, a musical dead end. This music no longer exists. And in this case, it's not really the fault of the people that created it, because, you know, they were murdered. But it is a piece of music that no longer really can be produced, because it doesn't have that whole intricately bound notion of culture and community in it. It is this. It is a hokoka played by the Carpatho Ukrainian Village Orchestra. This is probably around 1937.
And what is a hokoka?
It's a particular type of dance, a fast dance, an exuberant dance, a dance intended to evoke joy. Okay. Thank you.
Man, I would like to have been at that party. So we were hearing a recording that was made surreptitiously. This is the story.
Yeah, I mean, because at when this recording was made, the dark forces that came to dominate Europe during World War II were just descending upon Ukraine. And so this was essentially an ethnomusicologist that had decided to pay a visit to this one village, and he fortunately recorded that before that village was wiped out.
So this isn't like hey, we'll make a record about what our parties sound like. So let's make it sound really good. This is the actual party. That's what the actual
That is a
party sounds like.
You can
I
hear in the
mean,
thumping in the background, people are moving chairs and hopping up and down, probably drinking beer, pinching women, doing all that.
yeah. So there's sort of this delirium involved, this sort of and we're talking about the purpose of music, it seems like. Happiness. That's one we haven't really touched on yet, and that's suitable for our final, piece of the day, that it does touch on not just happiness, but some sort of just raw exuberance, some
Yeah,
sort of
unrestrained.
unrestrained childlike zeal. It's incredible. I've never quite heard anything like that either, especially with all of the violin sort of scraping at the end and all the sort of it's just like it was amazing. I absolutely love that.
Well, you'll if you ever go to Epirus, if you go to some of the panajiri, particularly in my village of Vitsa, they play that technique of playing high up the neck of the violin and catching the harmonics. That's utilized quite a bit.
So there, this is, a tragic story, obviously, having to do with the end of culture, and how often that seems to come about in our existence. So much of what I can't help but think about in terms of having this music archived in some way, collected, is the idea of a kind of resurrection. Now, obviously, they can never be resurrected in the way that it was. And we can never have that party again, and we can never have those cultural connections and those particular people in that particular language group in that particular locality ever together in the way that they were. I have, however, seen so much music of late where people are specializing in, these regional identities of Eastern Europe, of Central, Europe, and trying to resurrect them in a way that's meaningful to their lives, to find fiddles that are out extinct, that were buried in tombs many hundreds of years ago, and then reconstructing them and reconstructing what the music must have been, and then interpreting it in new and what I found very often in very genuine ways, trying to connect. It seems like it's such an important thing for people today to connect to something that is part of a past. Part of a past that's better than some of the things that we've inherited, the best part of our past, something that you can reach, and we have to reach through time, through the lens of things often that are 100 years older or older, sometimes that have been discontinued, sometimes in the most horrible ways, and sometimes just from being left off. It's not all tragic, of course, and we have to reach across time and interpret them based on nothing more than our own ability to try to enter that same space in our self. When you listen to a record and your imagination starts to go, you hear it, you feel something, and then you try to create something in yourself that evokes that same thing. And so, while we're not making a continuous line, perhaps we are doing some work to honor these traditions. And I do wonder how many times in the past, in the deep past, cultural legacies have been interrupted as well, and how many times we've had to start over. And American music does seem, in many ways, to be an indication of what it's like to have to start over. And you're never totally fresh, right? It's never totally fresh. You always carry with you the legacy and the heritage and the influence of the past in ways that are deeper than you thought. And yet, we are often left on our own, and often alienated, and often need to create something. So it's really awesome to hear this piece and say, well, we can create joy too. I know I'm capable of that. I can listen to old records and I just don't have to be my old, lugubrious self. There's the possibility to remember that so much of the important influence of music is your ability to reclaim your right to be happy, to be childlike. But I guess to return to my key point, that's the idea of resurrection. I think is in whatever limited way is really important to me. And I wonder if you had, being a collector of these things and listening to them, had thoughts on that point.
Well, most of the time I have a pretty bleak outlook on that. You know, I mean, when I return to Greece, when I'm in Greece, I see continuity. I see traditions that are preserved not by the act of preservation, but rather by the act of participation. And I think that's a really important point that you see in places like Greece, which are more rural, which are slightly less developed, that are more backwards looking than they are forwards looking. I see that virtue of continuity with some break here and there, but I mainly see continuity in places like that. My record collection, though, it tells a different story. It's often a line of records where they represent dead ends, where traditions just cease to exist because no one wished to really participate in them at that point. And I think it does touch on one important thing that, you know, I play a disc, but I can't play the dancers. I play the disc and I can't play the people that are at the event. So when I go to a feast celebration, a panagiri in Greece, you're seeing all of that in every possible dimension. You're seeing the people dancing, you're seeing the people celebrating and loving one another, and you're actually able to hear the music. It's the whole tapestry interwoven right there in front of you. The disc represents only one dimension of that.
That's interesting. So at the very least, listening to a disc and any real recording at all is an act of imagination, and yeah, really intense imagination, because you have to kind of, you know, be historically informed. You have to understand, you have to really try to put your mind outside of, you know, your own immediate response, although that's going to be very present, and really try to understand where this was coming from in time and place, who was making it, and try to put yourself there. That's interesting, for so many reasons, and so much of what I think has changed with video being central to everything is that act of imagination is taken care of for us. So we watch music now instead of listening to it most of the time. And in watching music, you're seeing a video that's meant to say, oh, here are the beautiful people dancing. Here is the party that we invented, you know, that didn't actually happen, unlike the one that we had under our, you know, with our recorder under our coat. You know, here is the scene of nature that's been carefully edited together. I mean, here's what I want you to experience with my music. I've made the video. And without a video, and growing up without that, you know, I've had to listen to music. And I often find that there's a big extra step there. It's kind of like reading a book. You have to participate in a recording. You have to fill it in, you know, and try to understand. And you have that context with the music of Epirus, having been there so frequently and observed it. Does that affect the way that you listen to the records?
Now it does. Yeah. Now I have a tendency to judge records a lot more.
Based on how
based on having been in the context of where the music takes place, not just in Epirus, but throughout all of Greece and also southern Albania, that context still exists. It just is not static.
I see. Well, I guess that brings us to the end of our program. We're just over an hour, but I want to open it up to anyone who wants to ask questions for Christopher about these records, about music, about his travels, really anything that we've covered here today. I know that the comments don't appear on the Autumn Salon page, so you'll have to go to the YouTube page. If you just click on the player, it will take you there, and you can type in your comments in YouTube. So Chris and I will talk a little bit more, and if I see some questions roll in, then we will address those, or I'll have Chris address those, and if not, then we'll call it an afternoon very shortly. So thanks again, everyone, for your participation, and I hope you enjoyed today's program, and that we see you all again for our next program.
Yeah, so thank you, everyone, and I want to give a shout out to all my friends in Greece that are watching this, since I know there are quite a few. My what do you call it, hoodies? These are my buds, or whatever you want to call them. They're all watching.
All right. Well, I haven't seen any questions roll in just yet. It might be a matter of the functionality of the question box. So sorry about that. Unless I see another one come in here in just a moment, we will call it an afternoon. All right. Well, once again, thank you everyone for your participation and for being part of today's programming. And I look forward to seeing you next time. And thank you, Christopher, for being here and for sharing your collection with us.
All right. Thank you, man.